It's one of the biggest disasters in maritime history, the sinking of the Titanic. For generations, the story has captured the imagination of the world, sparking dozens of movies, including one that was made on the orders of Adolf Hitler. But why? Did Hitler believe a Nazi version of the Titanic could change the course of the war? Was this a new kind of battle? One fought not with guns, but with movie cameras.
Producing films or battleships. From the Nazi perspective, they're both classified as weapons.
It's one of the most incredible untold stories of World War II. It ended in betrayal, disgrace, and a tragedy even greater than the one it was attempting to portray.
They were shooting at us in the river. It's like a fish in a barrel.
It is a mystery that is still unraveling.
It was like a kamikaze, and he crashed into his own Titanic.
Now, using recently uncovered footage, hidden archives, and a secret diary, we piece together the story of Hitler's ultimate epic, the Nazi Titanic. The year is 1940. Across Europe, countries fall like dominoes before the formidable Nazi military machine. 3 million soldiers, 2,500 tanks, and 3,000 warplanes. But these are not the only weapons in Hitler's arsenal. He has another equally powerful one. Propaganda.
Right from the start, the Nazi Party saw propaganda as a political weapon, and also during the war as a military weapon. You couldn't just win the war through the military, and you couldn't win it just on propaganda.
Joseph Goebbels is Hitler's Minister for Public Enlightenment and Propaganda. His job? To whip up popular support at home for Nazi fascist policies. These are the days before television, and movies are the best way to get the Nazi message to millions. While Hitler is taking on the Allies by land, sea, and in the air, the German motion picture industry will lead the battle on the silver screen.
For the Nazis, film was an extremely important way of mobilizing audiences, of conveying ideas. And Hitler was fascinated by the power of film.
Wir stehen fest zusammen!
In 1935, filmmaker Leni Riefenstahl's epic movie Triumph of the Will set the standard for propaganda films and rallied millions of Germans to the Nazi cause. The massive rally at Nuremberg, attended by over 700,000 Germans, was skillfully orchestrated for the cameras. It signaled the resurgence of a mighty Germany and helped Hitler secure power. Both Hitler and Goebbels witnessed just how powerful a movie can be. Now they wanted to surpass Triumph of the Will with an even bigger propaganda masterpiece. In May 1940, Hitler invades France. German troops take Paris. And the Nazis set their sights across the English Channel on Great Britain. Meanwhile, 500 miles away in Berlin, a German screenwriter named Harold Bratt has an extraordinary idea for a movie, and it's pitched to the Minister of Propaganda, Joseph Goebbels. Bratt's screenplay is the story of Britain's worst ever maritime disaster, the 1912 sinking of the RMS Titanic. 1,500 people lost their lives after the ship struck an iceberg on her maiden voyage. So how could this historic British maritime tragedy help Goebbels win the propaganda war? To understand his thinking, you have to look at the history of the Titanic. The Titanic was the biggest passenger steamship ever built, an engineering masterpiece combining sumptuous luxury with record-breaking speed. The British had even boasted she was unsinkable. But her design had a fatal flaw. The chambers in her hull were not sealed. Once ruptured, seawater flooded rapidly through the vessel. The Titanic, which took more than 3 years to build, sank in less than 3 hours.
This was the Columbia and Challenger shuttle disasters, all rolled into one. Not just a huge personal disaster, but a national disaster. Hugely embarrassing for Britain when the Titanic goes down.
It was a story that Britain longed to forget. But could Goebbels turn it to his advantage?
It was, to some degree, a story about stupidity, a story about cowardice, and a story about greed. Now, those things worked particularly well for Goebbels. Why? Because it was British greed and cowardice and stupidity, their current enemies.
The Nazis are planning their invasion of Britain, and Goebbels desperately wants a piece of the action. He needs to smear England's reputation, and Bratt's movie idea is just what he is looking for.
Goebbels expected the Titanic movie to become a very spectacular film with a lot of special effects. But he also, of course, expected that the film would have a clear message against the main enemy of Germany, Great Britain.
But for Goebbels to succeed, he will need to distort the facts. In his version, the disaster will be blamed on Britain's corrupt ruling elite. Now, fully restored for the first time in 60 years, we can reveal the Nazi Titanic as Goebbels originally intended it to be seen.
Sir, Bruce Ismay.
The Titanic's owner, Bruce Ismay, who is British, but in the movie speaks German, is falsely portrayed as willing to risk the ship's safety to make a profit.
Denn in diesem Augenblick, meine Damen und Herren, erleben Sie die Sensation, dass die Titanic 26,5 Seemeilen in der Stunde läuft. Das heißt, wir fahren Weltrekord.
Ismay ist doch ein Genie.
Und jetzt gehen wir zum Kontor hinauf und bestellen telegrafisch so viel Aktien, wie wir kriegen können.
Dann aber schnell, bevor die Sache in der Zeitung steht.
What you see in the film Titanic is actually the ship being portrayed as kind of a microcosm of British society, in which you have this small group endangering the safety of the entire society in order to reap financial reward.
Goebbels greenlights the project. If all goes well, the Nazis' Titanic will be a propaganda masterpiece, turning hearts and minds against the British. He approves a record budget of 4 million Reichsmarks, the equivalent of 180 million US dollars. But will he succeed? Or could Goebbels' breathtaking ambition for this movie backfire?
This, remember, is at the height of a war. Rationing is in force. The German people themselves are drinking coffee made from dried dandelions. And somebody has $180 million to spend on a movie.
Goebbels has other goals besides whipping up hostility against the British. He wants to create a blockbuster that will outdo anything Hollywood has ever produced. But even more, Goebbels wants to make Germany the leader of world cinema.
It's a big movie. It's like a Hollywood movie. And I think this was the basic idea. We will produce our own Hollywood movies.
If Titanic is going to be the blockbuster to end all blockbusters, Goebbels doesn't just need a director to bring his vision to the screen. He needs a creative genius, but also someone who will fall in with the party line. Goebbels chooses an ambitious director and Nazi party member, Herbert Zelpine. Zelpine is an A-list director who has already made two propaganda films for Goebbels.
Zelpine was a young, dynamic director, very skillful, and he was specialized, one can say, upon movies with an action content. Goebbels liked his works, he liked his films. He displayed a very physical kind of cinema, extremely commercially successful movies.
With Zelpine at the helm and a record-breaking budget, the Nazis' Titanic looks like it is going to be a hit. For Zelpine, it's the chance to create a masterpiece that could seal his reputation as Germany's greatest director. For Goebbels, it's a dagger aimed at the heart of Great Britain. Both have massive egos and everything to lose. The relationship between these two men will be critical to the success of the movie. It could even alter the course of the war. And for both men, there is just one person they have to please. Their ultimate audience, Adolf Hitler. July 1940. With most of Europe under his control, Hitler has set his sights on his next target, Great Britain. He launches wave after wave of bombers across the English Channel. The aim? To annihilate British air defenses before launching an all-out invasion and occupation. Meanwhile, in Berlin, Nazi propaganda chief Joseph Goebbels has just greenlit Germany's biggest ever movie project. Goebbels has used movies in the past to successfully rally the German people around Hitler. Now he wants to go even further, to use movies to justify not only an invasion, but a complete takeover of England. His movie, Titanic, will tell the story of the world's most famous maritime disaster. But for it to succeed as propaganda, he will need to hijack the memory of the tragedy and twist it for his own ends.
The story of Titanic, simply told, if you like, isn't really very interesting. Ship hits iceberg, ship sinks. You need a bit more than that. And the more that the Nazis brought to it was actually quite devilishly sinister. What they devised was a plot that, in their eyes, demonstrated the wickedness, the greed, effectively, of the British financial establishment.
The movie opens at a meeting of British stockholders.
Meine Herren Aktionäre, ich habe die außerordentliche Generalversammlung der White Star Linie einberufen, um Ihnen folgende Tatsachen zur Kenntnis zu bringen. Wir haben die Titanic gebaut, das größte Schiff der Welt.
Bruce Ismay is chairman of the White Star Line, which owns the Titanic. In an entirely fictional scene, Ismay tells his inner circle that Titanic's maiden voyage will make them all rich.
Nächste Woche tritt die Titanic ihre Jungfernfahrt über den großen Teich an. Und Sie, meine Herren, nehmen als meine Gäste daran teil. Sie werden auf dieser Fahrt eine sensationelle Überraschung erleben. Eine Überraschung, die unsere Aktien in ungeahnter Weise nach oben schnellen lassen wird. Dem Stolz.
The very opening of the film, where you're in a stockholders meeting, and yet you have this, the idea of the small group even within that, of speculating in stock, hoping to make a killing.
Sir, Prost Ismay.
Ismay plans to break the record for an Atlantic crossing, driving up the company's share price, a goal he will pursue with total disregard for the safety of the ship and all its passengers.
Also, Captain, wir verstehen uns. Im Falle der programmmäßigen Ankunft in New York zahle ich Ihnen $5,000. Und für jede Stunde, die wir früher eintreffen sollten, nochmals je $1,000. Also, je höher die Geschwindigkeit Ihres Schiffes, umso höher Ihre Prämie.
Ismay, in the story, bribes the captain of the ship to set this world record. and to show how money rules this entire society.
The propaganda message of the film, in some ways, quite simple and straightforward. It demonstrates this idea that a society is really in collapse when it begins to value profit over people. Really is an important message that I think that Goebbels' propaganda ministry really hoped to put out there.
Only by twisting the facts can Goebbels achieve the message he wants to convey. That Britain would be better off ruled by the morally upright Nazi Party. Goebbels has high expectations of the man he has picked to direct his movie, Herbert Celpin. He hands Celpin control of the script and gives him an enormous budget, the equivalent of $180 million in today's money. Notorious for his charm, energy, and his massive ego, Celpin has one fatal flaw.
His deficit was he had also quite a temper, and sometimes he just broke out in anger when something didn't quite go the way he preferred.
Celpin is also a member of the Nazi Party, because he knew that the only way to get ahead in the German movie industry is to be a Nazi.
There were so many movie people who actually were no Nazis, but they had arranged themselves with the system, with the regime.
The vast majority of film professionals working in the Nazi film industry were not particularly political. They were careerists, opportunists. They just wanted to do their job and do it well.
This is one of an extraordinary collection of Celpin's home movies seen here for the first time. Here we see Celpin in 1940 on location of his propaganda movie Carl Peters. An adventure film about a German explorer that attacked British policy in Africa. Celpin pulled vast resources for the film, transforming the Bavarian countryside into African jungle. And as with all big propaganda movies, the German army was on hand to help out. But as the war progresses, Celpin finds himself increasingly out of step with events in Germany.
Celpin hated uniforms and he hated authorities. So there must have been a natural conflict when the Nazis took over and they were marching around in uniforms all the time.
Is his star director, Herbert Celpin, the man that Goebbels believes him to be? September 1940. The Germans plan to have troops in London by Christmas. Goebbels' Titanic movie will vindicate their actions. But the Brits are proving surprisingly resilient. Having failed to destroy Britain's air defenses, Hitler changes tactics. Now he hurls Luftwaffe forces against the civilian population in a bid to bomb the British into surrender. Night after night, bombs rain down on London, leaving thousands dead. But in spite of the devastation inflicted on them and the enormous loss of life, morale in Britain is at an all-time high. The Germans aren't the only ones who understand the value of propaganda. Churchill also knows a thing or two about good PR. The British are working on their own movies, supported by the brand new Ministry of Information. But they don't have the budgets the Germans do. Went the Day Well is a movie that portrays the British as ready and willing to resist a Nazi invasion.
The film dramatizes a fictitious German invasion of England centered on a small rural village at Bramley End. They're eventually defeated when the villagers come together, people from all backgrounds, and retaliate and fight back, really quite brutally, against the German invaders.
Missed him. Can't even hit a sitting jury.
It was closely followed by Noel Coward's In Which We Serve, the story of a British destroyer which is torpedoed by the Germans.
When you see the whites of their eyes.
The ship, the destroyer, HMS Torin, comes to represent, as it were, the national community pulling together in the war effort. And this is powerfully expressed through the metaphor of all the men, regardless of rank or class, clinging together to a life raft waiting to be rescued.
Three cheers for the ship. Hip, hip, hooray! Yay.
In Which We Serve as one of the most successful British films of the war. It was admired by critics.
Hip, hip.
But it was also very popular with cinema audiences.
Look out, they're coming again.
The film does not spare audiences the full horror of war.
This isn't overtly patriotic, flag-waving, false heroics, but something that audiences could relate to as being an authentic experience.
This is the battle the Nazi Titanic had to enter and win. With a budget 12 times the size of In Which We Serve, the pressure on Salpin is mounting. One wrong step could have disastrous consequences. But unbeknownst to Salpin, there's a spy on the team who's ready to sink the Titanic's director. September 1941. Great Britain continues to hold out against Hitler's onslaught. In Berlin, movie director Herbert Salpin assembles a team to start work on Goebbels' anti-British blockbuster, a Nazi version of the story of the ill-fated Titanic. This is one of the most incredible untold stories of World War II, which until now has been shrouded in secrecy. A remarkable document, hidden in a German state archive since the war, finally lifts the veil on this ill-fated production. This is the original production diary of the Nazis' Titanic, kept by art director Fritz Maurischat. For head archivist Wolfgang Jakobsen, it provides a unique insight into the forgotten epic, a first-hand account behind the scenes of the Nazi Titanic.
It is a document in which Maurischat kept his notes from his films through the 1940s, including Titanic. It was a prestigious production, and one that held a particular significance for the propaganda minister.
The diary reveals the scale of Salpin's ambitions for the movie. His requests are staggering. He asks for 87 shooting days, a lot even by today's action movie standards. He wants 9 huge sets of the ship's interiors built in Berlin. He commissions a 20-foot replica of the Titanic for a model shoot of the sinking. And for the exterior shoot, insists on a full-sized ship. With the war raging across Europe, Salpin's demands seem like madness. But Goebbels believes that victory for Germany needs not just military strength, but high morale. He agrees to all Salpin's demands.
Since the Titanic was considered as being an important war movie, Salpin was able to succeed in fulfilling all his demands.
It showed the importance that the Nazis placed on propaganda, that they saw propaganda as such an important political and military weapon that they were willing to devote those kind of resources to it.
Joseph Goebbels, the architect of the Nazi propaganda machine, also has his own secret agenda. A victim of polio in childhood, he is excluded from the military.
His right leg is disabled, lame. He can't serve in World War I. He can't line up with the veterans, with the medals, and that haunts him throughout his life. What can he do? What he can do is propaganda.
He needs to prove that his role as Nazi spin doctor is vital for Germany's ultimate victory. For years, historians have tried to understand and piece together an accurate portrait of Goebbels. The control freak, the mastermind of the Third Reich. But another recent discovery has shed new light on Goebbels' ugly motives. A researcher exploring the Russian state archives found a microfilm containing the lost sections of Goebbels' diaries. It's now housed in the Institute of Contemporary History in Munich.
This is a microfiche reproduction of the Goebbels' diaries with its original handwriting, which is very difficult to read.
Goebbels' deep hatred of the Jews screams out of every page. December 1928, after watching his first Hollywood movie, Goebbels writes, "Sheer hell. Virtually all you saw were Hebrews." And a few months later, the Jewish question is the question of all questions. When he became the head of the Ministry of Propaganda in 1933, Goebbels was finally in a position to indoctrinate a nation with his poisonous rhetoric. Goebbels' first act as propaganda minister was to burn tens of thousands of books which were unsympathetic to the Nazis. His goal? To give German people a Nazi version of history. Goebbels then set out to demonize the Jewish population on the silver screen. In 1940, he released two anti-Semitic films to prepare the German public for the eradication of the Jews. The first was a documentary, Der ewige Jude, The Eternal Jew. It portrayed Jews as parasites on German society.
Wir erkennen, dass hier ein Pestherd liegt, der die Gesundheit der arischen Völker bedroht. Richard Wagner hat einmal.
You have rats running across the screen. A very potent anti-Semitic image that the Nazis used of identifying Jews with vermin, essentially as being parasites feeding off the host population.
The message was clear. These rats should be exterminated. Across Germany and Poland, the Nazis were building concentration camps with the express purpose of liquidating the Jews, a policy so horrific that they needed to brainwash a generation of German youth.
Heinrich Himmler and the SS saw these as crucial for the indoctrination of his troops, those that would be going out and committing mass murder.
The metaphor of rats was used directly to provide justification for the final solution. Jews are represented as a destructive group that needed to be eliminated and eradicated in the interest of survival.
2 months earlier, Goebbels tried a different tack, using actors in a drama. Jud Zeus tells the story of a German village girl who is raped by an evil Jewish man. The film culminates with the villagers rising up to wreak vengeance on the man and expel all Jews.
The Jude must speak!
To Goebbels' disappointment, The Eternal Jew, the documentary, was a box office flop. But Jude Zeus, the movie, was a huge hit, seen by a staggering 20 million cinemagoers.
It conveyed a lot of the same messages that Der Ewige Jude did, but it did so using entertainment. And this is something that I think the Nazis capitalized on. How you get across a propaganda message, perhaps in a subtle way, using entertainment.
From now on, the course was clear. Not documentaries, but Hollywood-style movies. Human dramas with the power to manipulate the emotions. December 1941. To turn the Titanic story into a powerful drama, Salpin wants a script rewrite and demands his favorite screenwriter for the project, his old friend Valta Zerlett Ulfanius. The studio is reluctant, but Zerlett is a loyal nationalist with the talent to help make the movie into the blockbuster Goebbels is expecting. Salpin is delighted to have his friend writing the script. But will hiring Zerlett prove to be one of the greatest mistakes of Salpin's life? Hitler is at the height of his power and has launched the biggest offensive the world has ever seen. 3 million German soldiers invade Russia. In Berlin, the biggest movie of the Nazi era has also been given the green light. Its director, Herbert Salpin, has demanded a script rewrite and has convinced the studio to hire his friend to rework the screenplay. Valta Zerlett Ulfanius. As Salpin's recently discovered home movies reveal, Zerlett, here on the right, was also one of his oldest and most trusted friends. But how well does Salpin really know this quiet and unassuming man? And is he right to trust him?
Salpin and Zerlett were rather considered as being an odd couple because Salpin was so an extroverted, attractive, athletic person, whereas Walter Zerlett Ulfanius was a very skinny, always sick, very nervous person who smoked all the time, rather introverted, and he had some social problems to adjust. And Salpin was someone who helped him, I think, finding his way into society. They just grew together as a good companionship and as friends.
Zerlett is an extreme nationalist. Like Hitler, he had been awarded an Iron Cross for bravery in the First World War. Salpin and Zerlett have been a winning team on 7 of the director's previous films. With the shooting script ready, the next hurdle is getting it approved by the Ministry of Propaganda. Anne-Marie Graham worked in the ministry at the time.
Every script that was finished and was due to be done had to be approved first. At the propaganda ministry, we had a script department, and they looked more closely to see that there was nothing in it they didn't like. If so, they deleted it.
February 1942. Zerlett's script of the Nazis' Titanic has been approved by the Ministry of Propaganda. Filming finally commences on the Third Reich's biggest movie in the Johannes Dahl Studios in Berlin. Leading actress Sibylla Schmitz is cast as a rich heiress and to provide a romantic subplot for the movie. And to play his leading man, Salpin has hired matinee idol Hans Nielsen. Audacious twist, the Nazis have invented a character who never existed on the real Titanic. A heroic German officer right in the middle of an English crew.
So the Nazis were very clear about who the villains in the Titanic story were, as far as they were concerned. But of course, they also needed a hero. The hero of the Nazis Titanic movie just happens to be German.
Und die Maschinen sind ruiniert. Präsident Ismay wird schon wissen, warum er diese Geschwindigkeit befohlen hat. Läufer, wer fährt eigentlich das Schiff? Präsident Ismay oder der Kapitän?
Nielsen plays upright First Officer Peterson, a man with an uncanny ability to see the future and a remarkable in-depth knowledge of icebergs.
Es gibt Eisberge, die einen Umfang von mehreren Kilometern haben, und 7/8 eines solchen Berges liegen immer unter Wasser. Es besteht also die Gefahr, auf Unterwassereis aufzulaufen. Gefahr für die Titanic?
Ist ja lächerlich.
Die Titanic ist unsinkbar. Der Beweis ist noch nicht erbracht, Herr Präsident.
He's in effect the only one on board who knows that they're headed for disaster. He tries to get them to slow down, to adopt a much safer course. If only they'd listened to this German officer, all would have been well.
The end of the film leaves the viewer with no doubt that the German first officer is the movie's hero.
Na, du hast mal keine Angst, meine Kleine, komm. Ich bring dich schon zu deiner Mutter.
By spring 1942, Celpine's shoot is well underway. But the complexion of the war is beginning to change. Hitler has committed millions of troops to invading Russia, stretching Nazi resources to the brink. Every spare man and machine is needed if Germany wants to win. And America has just entered the war after Japan launched a surprise airstrike on Pearl Harbor. Now it's America's turn to take on the Nazis in the propaganda war, upping the stakes in the battle for hearts and minds.
So, of course, after December 1941, it truly is a world war with America involved. Now, what does that mean? It's not just sending Marines and aircraft carriers into the Pacific. Hollywood is mobilized, too.
The U.S. government quickly establishes the Bureau of Motion Pictures to work with the film industry. Before the war, movies were just entertainment. But now, they are an important part of the war effort.
Cut! Fine, great.
The studios have one brief. How will their movies help win the war? Hollywood has a new villain. Gone are the desperados and gangsters. Now the movies set their sights on Hitler and the Nazis. The biggest stars of the silver screen are recruited, and Hollywood's finest directors are assigned to command the fight back.
Casablanca is the story of those desperate to escape the Nazi regime.
Rick, help me.
They're filming, you can't get away.
The 1942 movie Casablanca starred Humphrey Bogart and Ingrid Bergman as two lovers caught up in the Nazi occupation of North Africa. It's become a timeless classic, but was conceived as an efficient piece of propaganda. Its release was timed to coincide with the big Allied offensive in North Africa.
Casablanca is really a perfect example of a Hollywood propaganda film, as it makes effective use of major stars. But if you look at the story, it's a story frequently told in Hollywood anti-Nazi films, focusing on groups of people desperately trying to make it to America.
He's looking at you, kid.
America is the land of freedom, and so all their yearning is directed towards making that passage across the Atlantic.
The success of Casablanca at the box office would have enraged Goebbels, not just because it was a skillful piece of propaganda, but because it tapped into his other great obsession, rivalry with Hollywood.
Hitler and Goebbels were Hollywood film buffs, so Hitler had seen all the big Hollywood movies. He liked King Kong, he liked Disney's Snow White, oh, everything was lovely. And Goebbels, he had special screenings of confiscated American movies in his ministry. He loved Swanee River, Mrs. Miniver, and Gone with the Wind.
In Goebbels' private theater, he and Hitler held screenings of Hollywood's finest. But because he didn't speak English, Goebbels had to have an interpreter whisper every line in his ear. Goebbels' private diary reveals insights not just into Goebbels the warmonger and fanatical Nazi, but Goebbels the film connoisseur.
The entry of 22nd December 1933. Goebbels writes, I gave the Führer 32 super films of the last 4 years and 12 Mickey Mouse films for Christmas present. He's very glad about it. Hitler will have much entertainment and joy out of this present.
The diaries reveal that Goebbels had a genuine interest in movies as an art form, not just as a tool of propaganda.
The Goebbels diaries are interesting for a variety of reasons. What I found the most fascinating part pertaining to film was his aesthetic judgment. We have numerous examples of him saying, saw a rough cut of X, hated it, actor has to be replaced, or the typical old style junk we don't want to see anymore.
Goebbels' desire for German movies to lead the world has led him into a bitter rivalry with Hollywood.
Goebbels and his cohorts always had an inferiority complex towards Hollywood and a worry, why are we not better than they are?
Before the war, Germany had been the powerhouse of the film business, and Berlin was Europe's Hollywood. Films like Fritz Lang's Metropolis and The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari revolutionized movies. But the Nazi Party's politics of hate had driven a generation of the most talented filmmakers and actors out of the country to America. Great directors like Fritz Lang, Billy Wilder, and Max Ophuls brought their talents to Hollywood. Many of the directors were Jewish.
Of course, instinctively, Goebbels knew that much of the talent that left Germany would have been better for Germany, but that talent, of course, was Jewish. But he wouldn't agree with this. He said, oh, we can do better without the Jews.
The loss of so much filmmaking talent fueled the war between the German and American studios.
With that long history of Hollywood stealing away major directors, this rivalry was an essential part of Nazi film and media politics.
Goebbels needed Titanic to be the blockbuster that would finally knock Hollywood off its pedestal.
Goebbels was still in competition with Hollywood. He still thought, we Germans have to prove that we are better than they are. We have to do something similar to prove to the rest of the world that we are as strong and as good in filmmaking as they are.
With America entering the war, Nazi resources are stretched to the limit. The Titanic project will drain the coffers of the Third Reich. Is Goebbels prepared to jeopardize the war effort to make his ultimate blockbuster? April 1942. The U.S. Air Force joins with the RAF, and German cities are bombed relentlessly. On the Eastern Front, the Russians, supplied with tanks and aircraft by Britain and America, have begun to fight back. For the first time in the war, the Nazis have their backs against the wall.
It's clear already at this point that for Germany, the conflict with the Soviet Union is going to be massive, it's going to be expensive. The resources of the Third Reich are going to be stretched to breaking point.
But even though it's a heavy drain on Nazi resources, production of his epic multi-million dollar movie is still a priority for Joseph Goebbels. Physically weak and unable to serve in the military himself, Goebbels needs to wield power through his movies.
He tried to handle German movies like a big war effort, so he could tell Hitler, I'm a soldier too. So everything was war, even movie making was war.
In Berlin, the director Herbert Zelpine is halfway through his six-month schedule. The first phase of shooting has been completed without a hitch. Now, he faces the movie's most technically challenging phase, filming the Titanic sinking. He has ordered the construction of a 20-foot replica of the ship. German movies were at the forefront of this technology, and they were especially good when it came to building scale models. Models are usually shot inside a studio under controlled conditions, but there are no water tanks big enough to float Zelpine's Titanic. Art director Fritz Maurischat is sent to oversee the shoot outdoors at Scharmützelsee, a huge lake east of Berlin. Zelpine's ambition for this film knows no bounds. He wants to be Germany's number one film director, and this is his chance.
They had to build a huge slipway outside the lake to sink the Titanic with the help of divers. To bring all the equipment to the lakeside, they needed about 25 trucks. It was really an immense logistical operation. But everything that could go wrong went wrong. We had fog, we had rain, we had storm.
Furthermore, the scale of the Titanic model is causing problems.
Usually you film it at a rate of 24 frames per second. But if you have a model of, say, 6 meters, you need more than 100 frames per second to make it appear more massive and bigger.
But this method uses up huge quantities of expensive film stock. And this gives Zelpine another problem. Where to find film stock in wartime Germany? To make matters worse, the electronics keep malfunctioning, causing the model to break down. It has to be repeatedly sent back to Berlin for repairs.
This would go on for weeks and weeks and months without sufficient footage.
As if he didn't have enough problems, Zelpine adds to his list of unrealistic demands. Usually, night scenes are shot during the day using filters to darken the sky. But this was not good enough for Zelpine.
Zelpine also demanded to shoot the sinking of the Titanic under real conditions, meaning at night.
They could have done it day for night, as we called it, using filters, but they really had the night shooting.
This meant a bigger production budget. This meant more time and more lighting.
And there's another problem, the war. The RAF has begun a nighttime bombing campaign of Germany.
Of course, they had to watch if there would have been air raids.
The entire country is under a strict blackout at night. Any lights could guide the enemy and reveal German targets. Lights left on could also lead to trouble with the Gestapo. Big, bright movie lights are certain disaster. But with the full backing of Goebbels' ministry, Zelpine is allowed to ignore the blackout. It seems nothing is going to stop the filming of the Titanic. Zelpine is given everything he wants, provided he tows the Nazi line. As Allied bombs devastate Germany, Goebbels' obsession with the Titanic movie intensifies, and so does his paranoia.
Everybody was in a uniform and was commanding troops and this and that. And for him, he only was in charge of German movies.
Goebbels needs to show Hitler that his role as propaganda minister is still of paramount importance to the Third Reich. Hitler has tightened his grip on power by playing Germans off against each other. Mutual distrust and suspicion are rife across the country.
The whole system was working on denunciation, the whole system in Nazi Germany. There were many people around quite willing to say, oh, this person said this and that person said that, and that was it. But at that time, you could lose your life.
The wartime film industry is no different. Goebbels has informants everywhere.
Every team had a confidential member of the Gestapo who were expected to report anything that happened on set. So they had actually spies within their team.
Simply making jokes about the Führer or defeatist comments about the war could carry a death sentence. But Celpin does not heed the warnings. Knowing that his and Goebbels' careers rest on the success of the Titanic movie, Celpin goes even further. He decides that for the wide shots of the Titanic at sea, a model isn't good enough. He wants a real ship of similar dimensions to the colossal RMS Titanic.
Of course, they could have done the whole Titanic film inside the studio, but movie people like to travel. And they always say, oh, we like to be authentic. It should be a realistic view, so we need a real ship.
Celpin insists the ministry finds him an ocean liner big enough to double for the original Titanic. But there's a problem. All the steamships big enough have been forced into military service. To commandeer one seems impossible. Every ship is needed for the war effort. Every military mind is focused on Russia, where the failed Operation Barbarossa is claiming thousands of German lives. But for Goebbels, this film is his priority. Incredibly, he orders the Naval High Command, already engaged in war on several fronts, to hand over one of their ships. The German Navy released the Cap Arcona, a luxury liner being used for training U-boat crews on the Baltic Sea. With Goebbels' backing, the ship is theirs. Docked in the port of Gottenhafen, the German Navy's gateway to Russia, the Cap Arcona is about to be turned into a floating movie set. At the end of April 1942, Herbert Celpin heads east for Gottenhafen to film the all-important scenes of the sinking aboard the Cap Arcona. Trusted friend and screenwriter Walter Zerlett is already on location. He's been organizing extras from the German Navy and rehearsing the actors ready for the start of filming. But there's one thing Celpin does not know about Zerlett. Zerlett's loyalty to the military is greater than his loyalty to his friend. He's about to sabotage Celpin and change course on the production of the Nazi Titanic. May 1942. Allied airstrikes on German cities have intensified. The war has come home for German civilians and has become a fight for survival.
In 1939 and 1940, it was still okay. We were going to the cinema, but then it got worse and worse. You had to bundle together your hand luggage or whatever you had and go quickly into the cellar. But many cellars got hit too. The bombs came in sideways through the windows, through the cellar windows. They didn't always come downwards, the bombs. They also came down like this. And of course, many things were destroyed.
But despite this devastation, Minister of Propaganda Joseph Goebbels' chief obsession is to produce a blockbuster movie that will rival anything Hollywood has ever produced. He's even commandeered a passenger cruise liner. The Cap Arcona will no longer be used to fight the enemy, but to make a movie. Herbert Celpin and his production team have relocated to Gottenhafen, a key strategic naval base on the northern coast of Poland, where the Cap Arcona is docked, to shoot the exteriors of the RMS Titanic. Ordinary Germans are facing severe rationing. But for Selpin and his team, it seems like there is no war.
Filmmaking is a world in its own. It's a microcosm, and you can feel very comfortable inside. First, you are indispensable at that time. You don't have to go to the front. You don't have to be a soldier. So you can go to a nice resort.
The aim of the Titanic film is to condemn the decadence and corruption of the British. But the film cast and crew are indulged with every vice that the Nazis supposedly condemn.
They got all alcohol and liquors on that. And they had music and women.
And Selpin doesn't just succeed in commandeering a military vessel. He turns a five-star hotel in the nearby town of Sopot into his production base. Government planes are occupied, taking Selpin and his team back and forth to Berlin to view the rushes. But most shocking of all, Goebbels provides the director with hundreds of soldiers as extras who might otherwise have been on the front line. For a country at war, the resources supplied to Selpin are astounding.
In those days, there were many uniforms around. When you shot a movie, you got, of course, many soldiers to help you. So the army were at hand anytime.
Selpin finds himself the director not just of his actors, but of troops from both the German army and navy.
You could command. You are a commander. You have soldiers around. You say, go there, go here, come there. You are sort of a general in movie making.
At first, Selpin is in his element.
Selpin liked to gather around after a day of shooting, and they drank and talked about daily life and politics, and also, of course, made a lot of jokes about the ruling government. This was something quite usual. And Selpin expected, of course, his team to be confidential about all what had been talked about after hours.
But Selpin's charmed world soon starts to unravel. Months of wartime denial and fear have taken their toll on the actors and the military personnel who have been assigned to the project. Like a pressure cooker, the film set now boils over. They turn up drunk, constantly flirt with female members of the cast, interrupting takes and costing film, time, and money. Making matters worse, sirens from the naval base interrupt every take.
There were people running around all the time, watching the shoot. There were noises from the harbor, like big ships, warships coming and going. So there was a constant scene of noise and interferences that made this shoot impossible.
And the actors keep forgetting their lines. Selpin has been shooting on the Cap Arcona for weeks, and he hasn't even got one scene in the can.
So he was fed up with it all, in a way, and this emotion brought him to fall.
Selpin calls a crisis meeting at the hotel.
They got together for dinner, and during this occasion, he started to blame the German army.
Selpin blamed Zerlett for failing to rehearse the actors and allowing the soldiers to run riot. Zerlett replies that the soldiers are war heroes and it is not his place to scold them. This is too much for Selpin.
He knows that the last thing you should do in a totalitarian state, and particularly one that's at war, is shoot your mouth off, but he seems to forget that.
He shouts at Zerlett and loudly curses the army and even the Nazi war effort. He ridicules the ultimate symbol of German military pride, Zerlett's Iron Cross. But Salpin has underestimated his friend's loyalty to the Third Reich.
Herbert Salpin directed his outburst towards his friend, Walter Zerlett-Olfenius, who took military honor very seriously. He felt extremely offended.
Zerlett's mind is made up. The next morning, he walks out on the production. He takes the train back to Berlin and reports the incident to the ministry.
I think Zerlett must have felt abused by Herbert Salpin in a way. So, to some extent, his reaction was kind of a revenge to this feeling of humiliation.
Anne-Marie Graham, who worked at the Ministry of Propaganda, is the last remaining person alive to remember what happened next.
Ich sah das Denunzieren, also das Anzeigen war ja so verbreitet.
Denouncing, informing, was so widespread. That was the bad thing. You always had to know who you were talking to. This is what happened to Salpin.
Zerlett tells the propaganda ministry that Salpin has insulted the army and the German war effort.
The so-called defeatist comments made by Salpin, army, Iron Cross, they happen in a row between friends. Both of them a bit drunk, of course. Zerlett didn't need to take these comments any further.
When Zerlett signs the official report, he sets in motion a chain of events which will lead to a final showdown between Herbert Salpin and Joseph Goebbels, and possibly the end of the Nazi Titanic. July 1942. The Nazis are in a final push for military victory and domination of Europe. In the Atlantic, the German U-boat offensive is gaining the upper hand. On the Eastern Front, Hitler has made a last bid to capture the Russian city of Stalingrad by attacking from the Volga River. Betrayed by his friend, scriptwriter Walter Zerlett, Herbert Salpin has been summoned to Berlin, and filming of the Titanic movie slows to a crawl. He is interrogated by the Gestapo for making defeatist comments about the progress of the war and criticizing the Third Reich.
The questioning of Herbert Salpin by the party and state authorities lasted for weeks and months, and Herbert Salpin got more and more traumatized by the situation. And he also mentioned that, in a way, he saw no meaning of life anymore. He was so shocked and he was deeply afraid that he could lose his job and also lose his life.
In between his interrogation sessions, Salpin goes back to shooting, and he must now film the climactic drowning scenes.
In the last week of July, Herbert Salpin shot the scenes in the sinking Titanic and water already reaching up to his legs. So this is a very ironic and symbolic situation he was working in. A director directing more or less his own downfall, his own drowning, while he was directing the Titanic.
July 31st, 1942. Salpin is summoned to the Minister of Propaganda's office on Wilhelmstrasse, Berlin. Word of his outburst against the German military has now reached Goebbels himself, and the minister wants to interrogate the director personally. There is little question now of Salpin's impending fate. In an attempt to save his friend, art director Fritz Maurischat appeals to Serlet to intervene. But he won't recant. And Maurischat's diary reveals Serlet fully understood the consequences of his actions.
This is an extract from the memoirs of Fritz Maurischat on the 6th of May, 1942. In a final attempt by Maurischat to soften the rhetoric of Serlet, Serlet says to Maurischat, "I am the gravedigger of my best friend."
Selpin now comes face to face with Goebbels. He has one last chance to save his life. He could deny the charges, but instead, he stands by his anti-Nazi outburst.
Goebbels, he asked him, "Did you say this?" He said, "Yes, I have said, these are my remarks. I attacked the German army. I said this and that." And Goebbels asked him, "And do you think this is true?" And he said, "Yes."
Goebbels is livid. He had put his trust in Selpin to make a film for the glory of the Third Reich. Instead, he was endangering the entire project. Selpin's defiance under questioning seems suicidal.
He was fully aware of what he said. He must have been fully aware about denunciation and things like that. So he knew he was, he would face this situation. It was like a kamikaze. That was a kamikaze, and he crashed into his own Titanic.
Selpin, they arrested him and locked him up.
August 1st, 1942. In the basement prison cell of the police headquarters in Berlin, Herbert Selpin is found hanging, his suspenders tied around his neck. Goebbels' personal diary records.
Entry 1st August 1942. The director Selpin had committed suicide in his prison cell. This way, he came to the conclusion the court would have done.
But was it suicide or murder? It's a question that has troubled historians ever since.
There was some speculation, and for many years it was believed that Selpin was murdered.
Goebbels now orders movie director Werner Klingler to finish the film. No one is allowed to mention Selpin's name. In mid-October 1942, the movie that has cost director Herbert Selpin his life is finally finished. But the story of Hitler's Titanic is only just beginning. Goebbels has yet to even see his masterpiece. And a new disaster is about to unfold, more tragic than the original sinking of the RMS Titanic. December 1942. 2 years have passed since the Nazis' Titanic movie was commissioned. Germany has changed. Hitler's eastward advance has ground to a halt at Stalingrad. The coldest Russian winter for a decade has thwarted Nazi supply lines. German soldiers are dying in their thousands at the hands of the resurgent Red Army.
There's no question at all that the Battle of Stalingrad was the turning point in the war for the Germans. Up until that point, everything had been a success. Ever after, they're fighting for their lives.
Devastating nightly raids by Allied bombers are sapping German morale.
Mothers and children were told to leave Berlin. Berlin was going to be razed, was the rumor.
Goebbels sits down in his private theater to view his long-awaited propaganda epic. It's cost $180 million and the life of its director. Having squandered untold resources, men, and materials of a country involved in total war, it's not long before he realizes he has made a colossal mistake. His diary entry records, "In the evening, Demanovsky showed me and some of my guests his new movie, Titanic. I don't like the end. It needs to be changed completely."
What does Goebbels see when he sits down to watch the movie is, amongst other things, a story of death, disaster, and ships sinking. He's thinking, do the German public, who many of them will have lost relatives on ships that have sunk, is this really what they want to be seeing?
He realizes the scenes of drowning men and women are more likely to demoralize than inspire a German audience.
The political circumstances had changed. Everybody was panicked. The daily air raids against Berlin and other German cities, taking shelter, all this reflected the situation on board of the Titanic. They couldn't use it because it would make people afraid.
The changing fortunes of war have given the film a meaning he never intended.
The elements of cowardice, stupidity, and general hubris that certainly do exist in this story could be a metaphor for what happened to the Third Reich.
Goebbels bans the film in Germany. Its director, Herbert Selpin, is dead, but some people believe that he is the unsung hero of the story.
There's another theory about why the film is never shown to Germans, to do with the first director of the film, Herbert Selpin, was using the film as a way of critiquing the Third Reich, and he was in some ways holding a mirror up to Germany and to its political leaders and saying to them, look at what you're doing. You're really endangering German society, German culture. There's a great example of this in First Officer Peterson, who at every turn he's kind of told by authority figures, just follow orders. This idea that maybe you should question power is one that I'm sure the regime was not really too excited to kind of put out in this point in history.
Could Selpin's portrayal of President Ismay be a subtle message about Germany's own leader, Adolf Hitler?
I think one way of understanding the Ismay character is to say that he's, in some ways, the leader of the ship. And Ismay is, in fact, the person who, more than anyone, is driving this ship into danger in ways that, to Peterson, at least, are completely irresponsible. You could say that Ismay is to the Titanic as Hitler was to Germany.
Could Goebbels, with his sophisticated understanding of propaganda, have been worried that German audiences might get the wrong message? Whether Salpin deliberately set out to sabotage Goebbels' propaganda remains a mystery. What we do know is Goebbels was worried enough by what he saw to make sure the film was never shown in Germany. But it's not the end of the story for the Titanic movie. Although banned in Germany, Goebbels approves for the motion picture to be released in Nazi-occupied territories. On the 24th of September, 1943, Herbert Salpin's Titanic holds its premiere in Prague. And the following year, the film plays across war-torn Europe, and people actually turn out to see it. The movie becomes the blockbuster Goebbels had longed for, but he still refuses to show it in Germany. The last report from Goebbels about the Titanic records that the propaganda minister sees no artistic or commercial value in the film. February 1943. The Germans are defeated at Stalingrad and begin to retreat. The Allies are gaining the upper hand in the Atlantic. But Goebbels still believes that if he can capture German hearts and minds, he can rally the country. February 19th. He delivers a rousing speech broadcast to millions nationwide. Goebbels calls on the entire German people to rise up and prepare themselves for a brutal last stand against the nation's enemies. Undaunted by the spectacular failure of his Titanic movie, he now commits to an even more ambitious movie project. He commissions Kohlberg with a budget of 8 million marks, half a billion dollars today. Kohlberg tells the story of the heroic defense of a besieged German fort during the Napoleonic Wars. The movie is Goebbels' last chance, and he pulls out all the stops. His megalomania has no bounds. Surpassing even Titanic, he orders thousands of soldiers from the front line to act as extras.
Whether this is evidence of Goebbels' increasing distance from reality, or simply that he recognized the end was there and wanted to produce the film as some kind of personal testament to himself and to the heroic resistance of the German people, perhaps we'll never know.
So wollte ich's von Ihnen hören, Nettelbeck. Jetzt können wir zusammen sterben.
With the war lost by the time the film was finished, Kohlberg was yet another propaganda catastrophe for Goebbels. But for the saga of the Nazi Titanic, its most gruesome chapter is yet to unfold. The Nazis' stand-in for Titanic will also sink, with a tragic loss of life three times greater than the Titanic itself. The Nazi forces' retreat proves as brutal as their advance. And one of their many atrocities gives a horrifying final twist to the Nazi Titanic project. January 1945. The Allies advance towards Berlin from the west, the Russians from the east. The head of the Gestapo, Heinrich Himmler, realizing that the war is lost, forms a horrifying plan. To erase the evidence of Nazi war crimes by killing any surviving inmates of concentration camps.
Himmler gave the order that no concentration camp inmate should be liberated and survive. They ordered death marches going from Neuengamme to Lübeck, going from Lübeck to Neustadt.
The SS marches thousands of inmates from camps inside Germany to the Baltic port of Neustadt, hundreds of miles away. There, they are ferried out to a gleaming passenger liner, the Cap Arcona, the ship that played the Titanic in Salpin's movie. One of the camp inmates was Henry Bavnik.
I saw this beautiful boat. We thought we're going on a cruise there.
But Henry and the other 5,000 camp survivors aren't going on a cruise. They have just boarded a floating bomb. The Cap Arcona now looks like a Nazi troop ship, but the SS has filled it with flammable gas and incendiary devices. The plan is to trick Allied bombers into eliminating these witnesses to Nazi war crimes.
It was clear that there would be an attack coming by the Allies. The ship was prepared by the Germans for a very fast sinking by an explosion.
Just minutes after Henry and the other camp survivors board the ship, they hear a terrifying sound. The drone of approaching RAF bombers.
All of a sudden, we see those planes coming, and we could hear that they dropped a bomb on the boat, but no big explosion or anything, but then we saw the fire started.
Also on board is Sam Pivnik.
And we had machine gun and we had bombing, but none of us was military orientated, so we didn't know if it was the bombing or the machine guns, or both.
The RAF bombers have no idea there are prisoners on board. A bomb strikes the Cap Arcona's stern and explodes, igniting the gas tanks.
I was on the other end of the boat, and also I was lucky that the wind was going toward where the bomb exploded. So we didn't feel much of the fire for a long time, you know. It took about 3-4 hours, and then I could see actually where the floor is starting to smoke.
The fire sweeps through the vessel. Soon the flames reach Sam on the top deck. He faces a choice: burn to death or risk a long drop into the freezing waters below.
Eventually, I was pushed near the edge of the top deck and I jumped into the water, hoping I can swim. I wasn't a good swimmer, but that's the only chance. You either burn or you swim.
As I watched down at the water, you could see how people, because a lot of people jumped into the water, you know. And I could see actually people go down for about 20, 30 feet. You could see how they all sink into me, not doing anything, just slowly going down to the bottom.
If the icy waters and the flames aren't enough, RAF planes are strafing the fleet, and SS officers are picking off anyone trying to escape.
And they were shooting at us in the river, and the aeroplane was machine gunning us as well. It's like a fish in a barrel.
Suddenly, the Arcona lists dramatically, sending more people into the sea. Only by grabbing hold of a rope does Henry manage to save himself from drowning.
And there I'm holding onto the rope, and there's about 300 people fighting to get to the rope. And within about 5 minutes, there were about 5-6 guys that actually held onto the rope.
As the survivors try to escape the freezing water, the SS are waiting.
As I come closer, there were police and SS shooting the people that came out of the water, and even shooting into the water. And I saw other people were ducking, and I did the same. So I still stayed in the water till it got a bit darker. And then I walked onto the land. But at that time, there was a lot of bodies lying around.
Back on the ship's hull, Henry is eventually rescued by a local fishing boat. He was one of the lucky few.
I must have had at least 50 friends that all died. That's only me. You know, 50 friends from the concentration camp that I was with them for practically 4 or 5 years.
Of the 5,000 who boarded the Cap Arcona, fewer than 350 survived. Its death toll was three times that of the Titanic. Just a few days later, the Nazis surrender, ending the war in Europe. This is the terrible final act of the Nazi Titanic. It wasn't until 1950 the movie was shown in Germany, with the propaganda element heavily censored. But it had a surprising afterlife. Some of the scenes shot for the Nazi Titanic were recycled in the classic British film, A Night to Remember. Salpine and Goebbels remain uncredited.